I forgot to start the recording. Do you consider yourself a superstitious person? Do you believe that you have to do things in a certain way to bring you good luck, or you're to avoid bad things happening to you? Do you try to avoid like black cats if they're bad luck, or breaking mirrors, or walking under ladders? So I always thought walking under ladders was bad luck because something could fall on you or someone. Generally, I don't consider myself superstitious. I'm too level-headed for that. I'm too logical, I think things through too much to be superstitious. And I have never believed that by like wearing a certain pair of pants will give me good luck for that day. I'm totally rational. Except when it comes to sports. As a sports fan, I am completely irrational. So, I like all sports, but I especially like football, American football. And whenever my team is on a winning streak, I have to wear the exact same jersey, the same shirt, whenever they play, to help them keep winning. And when I was younger, maybe about, I guess it was about 7 or 8 years ago, me and my dad went to a football game, a playoff game for my team, and our kicker missed 2 field goals during that game, easy ones. That's a kick to earn you 3 points. And it scarred me. So now, whenever my team is kicking an important field goal, I cannot watch it, because if I watch him kicking it, then he's surely going to miss. But if I don't watch, he'll probably make it. And just recently, a few weeks ago, my wife and I were watching the Super Bowl, the football championship game. And about 3 minutes left in the game, my wife says, "Oh, I'm sure this game's over now." And I immediately shushed her, shh, because everyone knows if you claim that a game is over before it's actually over, fate will intervene and the team you are rooting for will lose in the most unlikely way possible. When I told this to my wife, she said, "This game is recorded. It already ended several hours ago. What I say will not affect the outcome of the game." It's obvious my wife does not understand being a sports fan. There is no place for logic. You can control a game hours and weeks after it's finished, as long as you don't already know the final score. But of course, the truth is, I have no control over any football game, unless I was playing in the game, in which case I would immediately make my team lose because I was never playing football. But I like to pretend that my fandom, being a big fan, causes my team to win. But it really does nothing. But imagine you did have that kind of power, that you could control things and change things. Imagine you could determine what happens in each and every situation. That would be some awesome power. The type of power that God has. God has that kind of supreme authority, that kind of control over all things. We call this God's sovereignty. God is sovereign. But God doesn't just have this power. God also uses the power. God controls the ebbs and flows of all life. So, this immediately raises the question, if God controls everything, then why does God allow people to do bad things? Now, this question has a very long and detailed theological discussion. And so if you guys want, we can stay here for 2 or 3 hours and get into a really good debate about it. No? Okay. But, so I'm going to try to kind of boil it down. And it basically comes down to this idea. God can control everyone and everything. But God chooses not to. Instead, God gives us free will. This ability to make our own choices and our own mistakes. If God used his sovereignty on us all the time, we would be nothing but puppets. We'd be moving and talking, but there'd be no life behind it. God loves us unconditionally and seeks our love too. But would our love be worth anything if it were forced? If we had the power to make people love us, would they really love us? Or would it just be an illusion caused by our power? So this is why God does not force us and force humanity into every single decision. So, this immediately raises a counter question. If God has given us free will, then does God actually have sovereignty? Does God actually control anything? If God lets us do whatever we want? If God allows us to make our own decisions and allows bad things to happen, then is God still sovereign? The answer is yes. God can have both sovereignty and give us free will at the same time. A.W. Tozer tries to explain it in this way, and I think it's really good. Imagine we are all on a giant boat, a giant ship, maybe a cruise ship. I'm changing his analogy a little bit. A giant cruise ship going here from Korea, and we're going to sail all the way to America. The proper authorities have been given the ship's route, and the captain is leading the ship. There is nothing any of us can do to change the course of that ship. But we are not all sitting on that ship chained up to our chairs so that we can't move. We can go about, we can make our own decisions. We can live life the way we want on the ship. We can go around. We can play shuffleboard, which is what I would be doing. So God has given us this free will. We can move about, we can do what we want, we can live our lives. But that doesn't change the direction and the course of this ship, the course of this world, the course of humanity. Let's go back to our scripture, Romans chapter 8. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not even spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was raised from the dead, or was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Here in our church and in the Nazarene church, we often talk about how God has called us. Not just called to be a pastor, but all of us. All of us have been called to things, to live our life for God, to live according to God's purpose. And this passage reiterates that idea. But this passage also talks about God foreknowing us, knowing us while we were still in our mother's womb. And those God foreknows, He also predestined. What does it mean to be predestined? Is our fate determined before we even choose God? And those God has predestined, He also called. And those He called, He justified. And those He justified, He glorified. And so we are fine thinking of God calling us and justifying us and glorifying us. But this passage seems to indicate that God had plans for us before we even existed. This is truly an understanding of God's sovereignty in the world and in our lives. But once again, it makes us take a hard look at free will. Can free will exist if our lives have been predestined? Sadly, this question has, in some ways, split the Christian church. Different denominations have different beliefs. There are those people who really, those churches who really focus on predestination, and those who really focus on free will. And I find when you're like that, when you're a university student studying to be a pastor, people like to argue about this constantly. It's the argument that everyone has. And it feels like everyone is forced to make a choice. You have to either believe in predestination or you have to believe in free will. There's no middle ground. It's like Coke versus Pepsi. You can't say you like both of them. One is obviously better than the other. Or dogs versus cats. Or men with beards versus men with no beards. Though that's not really a competition at all. Just kidding. So, now let me say this up front. Mostly this argument that we have between predestination and free will does not affect our lives and how we relate to God. We have been saved by God. And that we have been given God's grace in our lives. In some ways, that doesn't matter if it's because I chose to accept God's love or because God predetermined that I'd be called this way to accept God's love. The end result is in some ways the same. If someone tells you that they have been predestined by God, so it doesn't matter how they live their life, it doesn't matter how they act, they're going to heaven because they've been predestined in that way, that person is a fool. And they don't understand how God's love transforms us and how God's love affects every action in our lives. And if a person says they have free will, they can do whatever they want. And God doesn't care whatever he or she does, as long as they choose God right before death, on their deathbed. He or she is also a fool who doesn't understand God's longing for us to be in his family. That God is like a mother waiting desperately for her wayward child to return home. There's a story of a group of theology students studying to be pastors, and they were discussing this tension between predestination and free will. And it became so heated, they decided they had to split into two groups, a free will group and a predestination group. But there was one student who could not decide which one to go to. So at last, he decided to go over to the predestination group. And so when he got there, they said, "Who sent you over to our group?" And he said, "No one sent me. I came of my own free will." And they said, "Free will? Get out of our group. You can only be in here if you were sent." So he said, "Okay." So he went over to the free will group. And they said, "Oh, when did you decide to join our group?" And he said, "I didn't really decide. The other group sent me here." And they said, "You were sent. You can't join this unless you decide on your own free will." Anyway, I found that funny. But in the end, God has known you and sought you since the day you were brought into this world, before you were brought into this world. God loves you, wants to hold you and me as a child. But if you do not accept God's love, if you run away and hide, that doesn't mean that God is not sovereign. God is guiding the world. God is guiding our lives. Even if sometimes we fall down and get hurt, and even if we run away. You know, if I were sovereign, I would make sure that my football team won every single game. And then they'd win the championship. And then I could do that every year. But in my heart, I would know they didn't really win it. It was not a fair competition. Sometimes you just have to keep your hands off and let things happen. That's what God does. So I guess I will not have any great power to cause my team to win. And I will just wait for them to win the championship. And on that day, it'll be pretty special. I will probably have been dead for 200 years by that time. But even as I am in my coffin, I will know that I helped my team win because I will be wearing my lucky jersey. God does not control our world by moving people around like chess pieces and forcing every event and every person to bend to God's ultimate will. God's in control. God's still guiding us. God is sovereign in our world. And we need to remember that. Because sometimes we watch the news, and it's just so depressing, the things that are happening. We look up and sometimes we think, where is our world going? And it's important for us to remember, God is still in control. And God is still guiding our lives. Let's pray. Dear Lord, help us to remember your ultimate power today. And you are calling us. Help us to continually accept that call. Help us be instruments to help you move and change. In this name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for resetting this. It just fell. I know.